You will never back God into a corner with your prayers. You will never challenge God beyond his ability. To respond. There is never going to be a moment when the defiance of your faith surpasses God's ability to respond. If you follow Jesus long enough, you will operate in the supernatural. I'm going to say that again because I'm not sure you believe me. If you follow Jesus long enough, you should operate in the supernatural. Let me try it a different way. If you believe what Jesus said, you will do what Jesus did. You see, miracles are by definition a violation of natural laws. Miracles are not logical. And our tendency is to explain away what we do not understand. But don't let the existence of what is incomprehensible keep you from believing what is authentic. You see, those who had heeded the words of Jesus were gathered in one place. And the unity permeated the atmosphere. Outside, the streets were filled with throngs of revelers. Many had come from very far away to celebrate Pentecost. And when the day of Pentecost was fully come, there had been other days and festivals of Pentecost, but no festival like this. Acts 2 and 1. And when the day of Pentecost was fully come, they were all in one accord and in one place. And suddenly there came a sound from heaven as if I'm so glad you listened. A rushing mighty wind. As of, it wasn't a rushing wind, but it was as of a rushing wind. You see, the writer is clear to tell us that it defied description what was happening. And the nearest thing he could relate to was a wind that filled the house. And it inhabited the room where they were waiting. And there appeared unto them cloven tongues like as of fire. And it sat on them. He said, it wasn't really fire. But the best I could describe, it was like fire. I know what it's like to serve a God that you can't explain. When he shows up, your words go out the window. You don't know what to say next. You know, I like serving a God who always has a surprise up his sovereign sleeve. I don't want a God I can explain. I don't want a God I can articulate. I want a God bigger than my definitions. Greater than my explanations. I want a God so much larger than my to explain. Because if you can comprehend God, you have a very small God. I don't mean to insult you, but if in your intelligence, you fully understand. After all, I want a God that I can't explain. I want a God that is bigger than me.
Amen.
That defies my ability to articulate.
Amen.
Give me a God that fills all space, knows all things.
Hallelujah.
Romans 11 and 36 said, in him, of him, and through him are all things. You see, it is a fundamental reality. We are better together. Our strength is based on unity.
Mm-hmm.
And if we lose unity, we lose power.
Mm-hmm.
We are structured according to Scripture in such a way that when we become divided, pitted against one another, we cannot operate in our proper power or authority. God has so created your faith that a greater degree of power is released when someone agrees with you.
Amen.
If any two of you agree as touching anything on earth, it shall be done unto you. Above all else, the enemy fights our agreement. One may put 1,000 to flight.
All right.
But two puts 10,000. Implying that there are battles that you cannot take authority over by yourself.
Amen.
And Satan will do almost anything to hinder agreement. The enemy consistently fights our ability to connect to each other. You see, when you and I truly agree, it releases the power of God in a special way. Imagine what would happen if you believed the scripture I quoted. Where two of you agree, touching and asking anything, it shall be done of them. Imagine what would happen. You wouldn't have time to go through the motions of a church service. You would not have time for the choir to finish their repertoire. But you would immediately look for someone to grab your hand and say, pray the prayer of faith with me. Rebuke the adversary with me. Plead the blood of Jesus with me. Tear off the roof with me. Someone who believes that when we pray, mountains move.
Amen.
What would happen to cancer in this house if we could summon the faith to believe that scripture? What would happen to diabetes? What would happen to revival in your church? You see, when the choir, when the worship team was singing earlier and the music was ministering, there seems to be a release of anointing.
Yes.
And I think we're confusing anointing for the power of togetherness. You see, it's not that these singers are anointed. That is personal discipline. Mm-hmm. That's a spiritual empowerment given to God because of your choosing and the disciplines that surround your life. But in truth, what we're feeling is less the anointing of the preacher and less the anointing of the singer and more the common agreement that you and I are coming into as a community of believers. You see, when they begin to sing, something we agree about. When your faith and my faith connect, there is a divine release of supernatural power that begins to settle in upon the house. When we begin to sing, you have no equal. You have no rival. You say, I agree with that. I believe you. I agree with what you're saying. And there is a divine release of apostolic impact that begins to take place in the house of God. That's why. Whenever you hit on an issue in your preaching and the people come into agreement with you, the power of God begins to fall. It's not simply that the man of God is anointed. It is that the man of God is preaching something that syncs with your faith. Mm-hmm. That connects with what you believe. Right. That's why you can preach a very good, a very powerful sermon, and a house be divided, and there is no release of anointing or authority. But when you preach it in a house where there are many nations gathered together, where there are all types of social and racial stereotypes in the house of God, there is a release of God's power. If you and I can get together tonight, something unique is going to happen in this room. You say, well, Brother Tinsel, I just came to hear the singing and praise God a little bit in general conference. Well, I did it.
Right.
I can praise God by myself.
Amen.
I can praise God in my room. I can do it in the shower, driving down the road in my automobile. I really don't need you to take my praise to another level. I can do that by myself. But what I came to do is hear a word from God. I came to connect with another believer who says, I'll just take your hand and we'll rebuke the devil off your family. We'll pray for a smooth transition. We'll take authority over the demonic influence that's limiting your church. You see, I just didn't come to praise a little bit. I came to find another believer that loves God like I love God. That believes God still does the impossible like I believe God does the impossible.
Hallelujah.
And that is exactly why it matters who you worship with.
Hallelujah.
You need to make sure you're worshiping with people that believe God can do anything at any time. You need to make sure you're joining your faith, attaching yourself to people that believe that your God has no equal or opposite. I am careful who I connect my faith to. I am careful who I connect my ministry to. I don't have time to connect with people that don't believe in a move of God. Does anyone still believe the blood of Jesus saves? Does anyone
Why don't you touch them right now and put the prayer of faith over their body right now?
Oh, hallelujah, hallelujah.
Faith and agreement, and God shows up. It's like a fire. It's like a wind. It's indescribable.
Chapter 4:1, one of my favorite scriptures in the Word of God, tells a story about a woman. I didn't tell you to stand, so I'm not going to tell you to sit, all right? You do whatever you want to do. 2 Kings. I'm going to go fast. If I go too fast in my American English, slow me down, okay?
We love America.
I wish I could imitate an English accent, but I really can't. So, come out something later. So, 2 Kings 4:1, a woman is losing her children to the bondman. The creditor is pulling them away. She owes a debt. Her husband has passed away. So she runs to the prophet and says, "How do I save my children?" And the prophet asked her, "What do you have in your house?" She said, "Well, I have a pot of oil, that's all." Let me make it clear, the oil is always enough. Oil is always enough. But yet the oil needed something for it to be multiplied. So he says this, and I've heard it preached many times, that all you really need is to have big faith. Big dreams and big prayers, and that if you have big faith, so go borrow vessels. That's what he told her. Borrow vessels, borrow not a few, and then come to your house, shut the door, and pour out of your oil into the other vessels. And so if you've collected 2, you'll have 3 filled with oil. If you collected 100, you'll have 101. So in other words, the size of the miracle is directly proportionate to the size of your faith. So if you dream big, pray big, hope big, then God will fill that space of faith in your life. Mm-hmm. I agree, that is true. But that is not the only hinge point upon which this miracle is based. It's very clear. The prophet said, "Go to your neighbors and borrow vessels. Go to someone you have a relationship with." Because the miracle is not just limited by faith. The miracle is limited by relationship. If this woman has never ever been a person who has built relationships with other ministries or other saints who partners with her for a future? If she's been difficult, if she's been angry, if it's always been about her, if she's been needy and pointing fingers of blame, high maintenance, difficult to deal with, does anyone loan her anything? You see, there is responsibility upon every individual in this house to be the kind of person that other people want to see free. You have to be the type of believer, the type of apostolic, that other people say, "Woo! I want to come alongside that gifting, that anointing, that relationship. I want to partner with them because I've seen something in them worth partnering." You see, the miracle is directly proportionate to relationship. So let me make it plain. You are not an island, and you will not survive on your own. You have to have relationships. If you want to break the back of demonic bondage that is stealing your children, you got to build relationships with people who have the same goals, and that is to. By a lack of self-worth and confidence in God that we don't think God can do it for us. Let me make it plain, the oil was never the limitation. The relationship was the limitation. God has enough to heal everyone in this house. God has enough to give finances to pay off every debt in this room.
that God's got enough? Does anyone in this house believe that God's got enough to give a breakthrough to your family? That God's got enough to speak across all of Great Britain? That it's not a singular revival for one particular church or organization, but it can flow from one.
We hear them speak in our language the wonderful works of God. Mockery and amazement are competing. The mocker said, "These men are drunk."
With new wine.
And I confess, I'm drunk. I'm drunk on God's goodness. And I'm never going back. I'm drunk on God's blessing and favor. And I can't get enough. I'm drunk on the greatness of His redemption. I'm drunk on His holiness. I'm drunk on His peace. I'm drunk on His righteousness. And I don't apologize. Simon Peter doesn't even deny it. He said, "They're just not drunk like you think they're drunk. It's not the fruit of the vine. It's the fruit of the Spirit." The psalmist said it's sweeter than the honey of the honeycomb. The mystery is finally revealed. The Holy Ghost sent down from heaven. The angels desire to look into it, hidden from the kings, the priests, and the prophets. God would send Himself to inhabit the soul of human beings. Greeks, Jews, Samaritans, Gentiles, all mankind would have the opportunity to be united in this ecclesia, this called out ones. The body of Christ. And it's more than a beautiful metaphor when Paul calls us the body of Christ. For you, with God inside of you, you are the hands, the feet, the mouth, the thoughts. That's what you are of God. That's why when you take the hand of another believer and you connect your faith, it's more than my flesh connecting with your flesh. We are the body of Christ. And when I touch the wretched shambles of humanity, there's a connection. Let me explain it like this.